And because he lives, we live also. Amen. Thank you so much for coming this early morning. And it's just an exciting time that we serve a risen Savior. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for this morning. Lord God, that we serve you, that you are alive. And Lord God, we follow a living Savior who conquered death, hell, and the grave. Lord Jesus, thank you, Lord, because you did all that you did on the cross, Lord. You made us, Lord God, able to go to heaven, able to look at death in the face and know, Lord God, that death will not defeat us either. God, thank you, Lord, for what you've done. Bless our service this morning. Thank you so much for everybody who got up so early to come. Lord, bless our time together in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated just for a moment here. Thank y'all so much for coming today. I want to take a moment just to look at the announcements just a little bit. The most important announcement is that we have donuts in just a little while. You know, I tell you what, just it's amazing how God uses even something like that. I was picking them up about 5:45 there and went in there, and the guy in the shop said, why are you having such an early service? And I said, because Jesus rose very early in the morning from the dead. And we're coming to commemorate that time. Because he rose up early, we can get up early. Amen? So we got to witness. Even it's amazing God uses donuts even to share that testimony. Just a few real quick things. We are having a meal this Wednesday. For those of you who would like to go and have a great meal with us, a time of fellowship this Wednesday before everything kicks off, $3 a person. And Debbie has started a new thing coming up here. It's called Sister Chat. It's going to begin April the 19th, where you ladies are going to get to come together and have a time of fellowship. It's just going to be a once-a-month thing that y'all are going to be doing. Also, we've got a singing and testimony time April the 25th. So if you'd like to maybe sing a song, I know some of you are just chomping at the bits. I can't wait. Stephen's going to be singing a song that day. Y'all come and hear Stephen Wonky sing.
He sounds just like Josh Turner.
He does. He really does. He's been holding back all this time. And it's his breakout session. I want you to know. So so that's going to be a great time. And we've got pretty exciting news. We're going to actually have youth camp this summer. That's exciting, exciting stuff. June the 14th through the 18th. So those of you who would like to get your kiddos signed up for that, that would be awesome. So that's really all I've got. Let's pray again. Father, we commit this service to you. Thank you, Lord God, for all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Y'all stand. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Low in the grave he lay, Jesus.
me give you a little bit of background here just as we go into these scriptures. The background is that Jesus was crucified, of course, on Good Friday, and his disciples all ran from him. Everybody ran from him except John, and John stayed with his mother at the cross. But they were all puzzled. They were all puzzled because Jesus had come, and they were expecting a conquering hero. You know, as you look at life, sometimes life doesn't work out like you think it does. Sometimes you pray and you say, God, do this and help us in this. And then all of a sudden it takes a different turn. And you go, Lord, what is going on? Because this is not what I expected. And so it takes faith to say, God, I've asked you to move in this, and it's gone another direction. So kind of what's going on? That's what they had encountered. They expected this Messiah to take on the Roman Empire. They expected this Messiah to establish his kingdom. And then he allowed. They watched Jesus heal the sick. They watched Jesus raise the dead. They watched Jesus feed the 4,000 and the 5,000. They saw the power that Jesus had to cast out demon spirits. And yet in that garden, as they came to arrest Jesus, he allowed them to arrest him. They manhandled Jesus. They drug him off. They beat him. They watched all that happen. In fact, the Apostle Peter stood back and watched them literally spit on Jesus, and he even stood right next to him and observed everything that had happened. And then they all watched him as Jesus drug his cross all the way to Calvary. And they heard Jesus say, "It's finished," and he died. Man, that was just so different from what they expected. And then you have Matthew 28, verses 1 through 10. Let's stand. Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly. Tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and indeed he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy. And they ran to bring his disciples word. As they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, "Rejoice!" So they came and they held him by the feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Lord God, thank you for these scriptures. God, thank you that, Lord God, we hear the rest of the story. God, thank you that we see the conclusion of why you came to this earth. God, thank you that we see the conclusion of all that you did on Calvary. We see the conclusion, Lord God, that you, Lord God, conquered death. Lord God, you conquered our sin. Lord, you conquered our mistakes. Lord, you conquered our failures. Lord, thank you that you conquered our defeats. You gave us victory. Lord, speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Jesus is alive. We serve a risen Savior. One of the things that separates us from all the world's religions is that they have a person that they look up to, that they worship, that's in the grave. The one that we worship, they can't find his body because his body is not in the tomb. And that's the one thing that Jesus had to convince his disciples. In verses 4 through 5, he used the angel to tell them because they were afraid. It seems like from the day we are born, we're afraid. The day that we're born, we're always having to calm down. We're always having to do something with our fears. We're having to face fear from the day that we were born and we go to school. We are afraid of the test. We're afraid of the teacher. We're afraid of the dark. We're afraid to drive. We're afraid about what may happen at home. We're afraid as we go into school and college. We're afraid when we go to work. And we're afraid when we have children. We're afraid when they get to be teenagers. We're afraid, and just constant. All of our lives we're having to face our fears. Then at this tomb, Jesus knew exactly. They were facing their fears again. They went to the tomb to anoint the body of a dead man. And when they got to the tomb stone was rolled away from it. And there was this supernatural being. There was an alien inside the tomb with this message. The message is, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Basically, it's okay. Isn't that a great thing to hear? Don't be afraid. It's all right. Everything's going to be okay. I know that you've thought the worst, but now you can rest. Be afraid. Don't be afraid anymore. Because he is not here. He is risen. And then he said, just as he was said. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18, there's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Perfect love casts out fear. Perfect means mature, complete love. Real love, in other words, real confidence in God Almighty does something against our fear. It throws it out. Our confidence in God confronts our fears. Fear involves torment, but he who fears has not been made complete. God wants to make us complete. And we become complete when we accept Jesus. When we accept Jesus, he is who we've been looking for all of our lives. I remember when I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior as a 17-year-old boy. The first words out of my mouth was, that's it. So that's it. It was like, okay, it is real. I mean, when you say a simple prayer and you pray to a risen Savior and the risen Savior literally comes to live inside your heart and he gives you that peace and that joy and he completes you. I said, so that's it. That's what I've been looking for. His resurrection removes our worst fears, but his resurrection removes, and this is the most important thing, removes death. John 11, we know the story of Lazarus. And Jesus told his sisters, he said, I'm the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. And then he said, do you believe this? And I've often said, to the degree that you believe it is the extent by which you have peace and you have confidence. And you know the unique thing about this story in verse 6, the angel said, he's not here, for he's risen, as he said. And he said, come in here, look, come on in the tomb, see the place where the Lord lay. My son Robbie and I got a chance to go to Israel And it was the most unique thing. When we went to the garden site, there was a big line outside of the tomb, big line. And it was a really unique thing. We all waited in line, Robbie and I waited in line, to go inside a building to see that it was empty. That's really what we got to do. We waited all that time, we looked in there, and we said, sure enough, there's no bones, there's nothing here. It was great. But it's kind of like we did exactly what the ladies did. They had to go inside the tomb to see for themselves. They checked it out, and sure enough, it was empty. One of the scholars said one of the evidences of the resurrection is that if the Sadducees and Pharisees and the Romans wanted to disprove the resurrection, maybe it was a fake thing. Maybe he really had died. All they had to do was show the dead body. All they had to do was say, here's the body, it's over, it's nothing to it. They couldn't find it because he had risen. Amen? They had nothing to show a skeptical world because he had risen. Come and see the place where the Lord lay. His resurrection removed our sin and its guilt as well. If you want to look at this in this way, as you go inside the tomb, your sin, your guilt has been removed too. It's not there. Amen? It's gone. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 17, said, and if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You're still in your sins. You see what this means? If he did not complete the story, if he did not complete redemption, then everything that we're about is futile. But he goes on to say, but now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. His resurrection removes hopelessness and gives a bright future. You know, we're not going to get away from death in this side of heaven. We're all going to be confronted with death. The Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die, and after that the judgment. We have an appointment. I've often said that's an appointment that we will keep. See, because the appointment is not dependent upon if we show up, no, death is going to show up. But the great thing about a believer is it's not going to be the end of a believer's life. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, according to His abundant mercy. I'm glad He didn't just say mercy, because I need a lot of mercy. According to His abundant mercy, He has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. His abundant mercy. Go in that tomb and look around. Jesus isn't there. Go in that tomb and look around. Your guilt is not there. Go and look around. Your sin is not there. Go and look around. It's clean. It's swept clean. What else can we do? Well, I like what he says in verse 7. Go quickly. Tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. Go quickly. You know, it seems like every single year that we have the sunrise service. You know, it's a little bit, I worry so much. Every year I just let y'all in. I worry so much that I'm going to be late. So I set my alarm. Debbie sets her alarm. I've got about three alarms. So whenever it gets up, this alarm will go off and that alarm again. And man, I'm just so afraid I'm going to miss it. And then finally I get on up. But the amazing thing is I get down, I go and buy the donuts and I go and I remember one sunrise service, I was sweating like I normally do, and here I am again sweating. Here it is, 6 o'clock in the morning, 7 o'clock, I'm sweating. And we're bustling around here to bring the donuts in. We're bustling around to get a mic check. And we're bustling around. And you know, here it is. And we see y'all come through the door. And we're excited about that. But you know what? There's something about this morning that you just cannot remain stagnant. You can't just put it neutral. Because you know what? This is special. This is a special day. In so many ways, this is special. This time last year, we couldn't have the sunrise service. We barely had something over Facebook, and we had such a dreary year. But this year, we get to come in this place and worship God on Easter morning. Hallelujah! It's worth sweating over. For that reason, go quickly and tell. His resurrection. Maybe you've been a little depressed this year. Maybe you've wrestled with depression. Anybody done that this year? I think we all have. His resurrection removes depression. Amen. Gives us hope. He gives us a reason to live. Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 28, He's basically saying, this angel said, go quickly, go tell the disciples. And then in Matthew 28, verse 19, Jesus told his disciples again, go. It's called go. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Go. It's okay to get out of your house. It's okay. Go. There's people in depression. There's people in hopelessness. Go. They need to hear. They need to hear that Jesus is alive. They need to hear that there's hope. Go. Amen. They also need to hear what Jesus can do. Jesus said in John 10:10, the thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy. We know what he does. But Jesus says, but I've come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. His resurrection removes despair and he gives us great joy. 1 Peter chapter 1, 8 through 9 says, whom Jesus, having not seen, you love. Though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice. Listen, with joy inexpressible and full of glory. And I love this last verse, verse 9. Receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. See, God doesn't wait. When you receive Jesus, He doesn't hold back salvation. He doesn't hold back reconciliation. He doesn't hold back forgiveness. He doesn't hold back being reconciled to God. All of that He gives you at the moment of salvation. At the moment of salvation, He gives you everything that you're ever going to get. He gives it to you the moment you say amen to that sinner's prayer. Receiving the end of your salvation. The end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Well, here we are, 2021. And I'm glad the story of the resurrection has not changed one little bit. The story is still as true as it ever was. Let's pray.